So I'm from Tilburg University, Department of Methodology and Statistics. So session on meta-analysis.
Is this better?
Yeah.
Yes?
Yeah.
Good enough? Okay. So session on meta-analysis, and I will start with a roadmap. So where does this session fits into the training, the research training? So first of all, of course, publication bias, it's over here, motivating issues. And also to achieve is meta-analysis. So how to do a meta-analysis. So this is basically the two topics that I will discuss. So I have two goals. One goal is to introduce meta-analysis to you and also stress some important topics for doing a meta-analysis. And another goal is that you understand what publication bias is actually, and also I will also explain some methods, how to correct for publication bias and how to test for publication bias, for instance. And among those methods are the P-curve method and the P-uniform method that we developed ourselves. Okay, so I'm from Tilburg University. I am quite lucky because I usually work with simulated data and not with real data. So I do not have the problems, usually do not have the problems of missing data, stuff like that, that you have with real data. So in that respect, I'm very, very lucky. And I'm working in a faculty of social and behavioral sciences. So it means that we are basically developing statistical methods that can be used for applying within psychology, sociology, organization studies, and those kind of fields. Okay, so something more about myself. So I studied a research master at Tilburg University. I'm now a PhD student working on methods for doing a meta-analysis and correcting and assessing publication bias. So I'm actually part of a research group in Tilburg University, which is called the Meta Research Center. So you can go to our website, and this is a picture of, it's an old picture. So you may recognize Marianne over here. She did the talk on the first day on the Researcher Degrees of Freedom. So we have to update this picture because three new PhD students started recently working in our group. Okay, so an overview of this session. I will continue with introducing meta-analysis to you and then also introducing publication bias to you. Then we may need a short break since this is a 2-hour session, just 5 minutes to stretch your legs and go to the restroom maybe. Okay, I don't want this. Okay. So then I will say something about different publication bias methods. There will be a small hands-on practical part if there is Wi-Fi, because we need Wi-Fi for this, so let's see how this works out. And finally, I will finish with some wrap-up part and conclusions. Okay, so why do we actually need meta-analysis? So these days, more and more studies get published on a topic that is of interest to you. So therefore there's actually some sort of information explosion, and how can we read all that literature? So how can we keep up with reading all that literature? So therefore there's a need for methods to actually summarize the literature that is available on a particular topic, and how to do this. That was actually the reason why meta-analyses and also systematic reviews were developed. So some history. Prior to the 90s, there was something what was called a narrative literature review. And you have to imagine that, for instance, there are 10 studies on a particular topic. Then there is a particular expert, and he has to assign weights to those studies and then come up with a final conclusion. So there's no statistics involved at all at that point. So of course, drawbacks of these methods are, first of all, it's subjective because we use an expert and the expert has to decide what is an important study and what is not. Then there is a lack of transparency because, yeah, how does such an expert assign the weights to those studies? And it's also, of course, hard to update if new information becomes available, because that means that you have to approach the same expert, ask, okay, if this new study is included in our meta-analysis, in our review, what can we say about our research question? Do we still obtain the same conclusion? Then there was some improvement, and that was with what was called vote counting, which you shouldn't be using nowadays. So what you do in vote counting is that you have you take a look at the statistics of the individual studies, and then you simply count the number of statistically significant results and the number of statistically non-significant results. And then if there are more statistically significant results than non-significant results, you conclude, okay, such an effect exists. So this is pretty bad, actually, because what you may know is that if the effect size is really small and your sample size is large enough, then every study will be statistically significant. So every effect size will be statistically significant. So that's the reason why you shouldn't use this method, the vote counting method. So then what we are using now are the systematic review and the meta-analysis. So a systematic review is actually just a clear set of rules that are specified in advance with respect to the inclusion and the exclusion of studies. And a meta-analysis is part of such a systematic review, such a procedure, as I will show later, because meta-analysis focus on the statistical synthesis of the data from separate but similar studies leading to a quantitative summary. So meta-analysis is a statistical part, actually, of a systematic review. So you typically have two goals in a meta-analysis. First of all, you want to estimate the average effect size, and you may also want to study the between-study variance. So basically this means, okay, what are the differences between the studies? And then what you also may want to do is you may want to examine whether there are differences in effect sizes caused by the study characteristics. This can be really helpful if you, for instance, want to use this for future research to generate hypotheses. So to show that meta-analyses are becoming more popular, this is a figure that shows on the x-axis the years ranging from 63 to now 2015. And then what you see is that there is an increasing trend suggesting that there are indeed more meta-analyses published. And also, if you are actually conducting a meta-analysis and you get it published, you will also be more often cited. However, I have to say that it's actually a huge undertaking to conduct a meta-analysis. So it gives you profit in the sense that you get more citations. If you're interested in that, you should definitely do a meta-analysis, but it's a huge undertaking to actually do such a meta-analysis. So the stages of a meta-analysis, or actually of a systematic review, are first of all, you start with formulating a research question. So the question that you want to answer. Then you also specify criteria for the studies that you want to be included in your meta-analysis or in your systematic review. Then in stage two, you're going to do the literature search. So you are looking for studies that you could include in your meta-analysis or systematic review. You extract relevant information from the literature. So for instance, information that you need to compute effect size estimates. Then there is the data preparation stage, which is very important, where you are going to convert all the effect size estimates of the different study to one and the same effect size measure. Then we get more the meta-analysis part, so really combining the effect size estimates by means of a statistical model. Then the sixth step, we do the interpretation and the sensitivity analysis. So sensitivity analysis also means assessing for publication bias. And then finally, in the seventh step, you're going to present your results. So you write a paper or give a presentation, for instance. So what I will do, I will mainly focus in this session on the fifth and sixth steps, so more the statistical part, so the meta-analysis and the publication bias. But if you are interested in how you should conduct a systematic review, then you can make use of one of these two books, both written by, one written by Cooper and colleagues and the other one by Cooper, about how you actually should conduct all those seven steps. Okay, so this is actually maybe the most difficult part of this session, the statistical models that you can use in a meta-analysis. So in principle, in its most simplest form, a meta-analysis is just a weighted average of studies' effect size. But we typically have to choose between two different models. So we either have a fixed effect, or also called a common effect model, or we have a random effect model. So first of all, the fixed, yeah? So an effect size, so if you do a study, and for instance you compute, so you collect data from participants, and then an effect size could be the mean of all the scores of those participants on a particular variable in which you are interested. So if you have multiple studies, then what you are going to do in the meta-analysis is you are extracting those effect sizes, so those means on that particular variable, from a primary study, and then you're going to combine these effect sizes in your meta-analysis. So we typically use two types of models, either fixed effect or common effect or random effect model. So how does it work? If you want to use a fixed effect model, imagine that we have 10 primary studies from which we have extracted an effect size. Then we make an assumption that there is only one true effect size underlying all those 10 studies. That's the what we are doing in a fixed effect model. So what then also occurs is that we can only draw inference in such a fixed effect model on the studies included in them in that meta-analysis. So we cannot generalize the results of the meta-analysis to studies that were not included in the meta-analysis. So this is in contrast to a random effects model, because in a random effects model we do not assume that there is only one fixed true effect size underlying each primary study, but we assume that there is actually a distribution of true effect sizes from which each effect size in the primary studies is sampled from. So then we, in a random effects model, we can generalize the results to studies that were not included in the meta-analysis. So you should also always use theoretical arguments to decide on whether I should use a fixed effect model or a random effects model. So basically, most of the researchers nowadays use a random effects model because they want, of course, generalize the results to the population of studies. So in a figure, how does it look like? So this is for the fixed effect model. So what you see is over here is a theta, and theta reflects the true effect size. So we have three studies, study 1, study 2, and study 3. And the blue dots reflect the true effect size in a primary study. So what you see is a fixed effect model, meaning that all studies have the same underlying true effect. Then what happens is that we cannot exactly estimate those true effect sizes. So we have to estimate those true effect sizes, suggesting that our observed effect size, our estimated effect size, will not be exactly equal to the true effect size. So these, the observed effect sizes, so what we see in the papers, are those red squares. So what you see is that the red squares are close, usually close, to the blue circles, but there is some sampling error over there. So we cannot exactly get for the observed effect size an estimate that is equal to the true effect size. Okay, so this is one of the two slides actually that contains formulas, so it's not that bad. So what is important to realize based on this slide is, okay, how do we compute the average effect size in a fixed effect model? It's just over here, it's a weighted effect size, weighted effect size estimate. So it's not that difficult, I would say. It's just a weighted average effect size estimate. Then now, how do we what kind of weights do we use in a fixed effect model? We just use inverse variance weights. So that means we have an effect size in a study, and that effect size is estimated with a particular precision. And that's reflected by the sampling variance. And what we want to do in a meta-analysis, we want to use some sort of weights to assign more precise studies larger weights. So that's actually what we are doing over here. So that's the WI. And then if we know this, then we can could use a simple Z-test to test the null hypothesis of no effect and to create a confidence interval. So this was the fixed effect case, where we do not want to generalize the results to a population of studies, but that's actually what we want to do in a random effects model. So what you now see is that there is no fixed value anymore for the true effect sizes, but those true effect sizes are sampled from a normal distribution, or sampled, assumed to be sampled from a normal distribution. So that means that the true effect sizes, the blue dots over here, are sampled from this distribution, and then so this is the one for the first study, this is the one for the second study, and the third study, and what you see is that those are not exactly on the same line. So the true effect sizes for the different studies differ. So there's also sampling error over there, so we can also not exactly estimate the, our estimate will not be exactly the same as the true effect size. So also over here, the red squares differ from the true effect sizes, the blue circles. Okay, then the second slide with the formulas. So what you now see is that we have, in the weights, we do not only have the sampling variance, but we also have a tau squared over here. And the tau squared reflects to what extent there is variance in the true effect size. So to what extent the true effect sizes differ among each other. And since it also has to do with the precision of an effect size, we also include this in the weights of the studies. And then once again, we compute a weighted average effect size with the same formula, but now we are using slightly different weights over here. And we can still use a z-test to test the null hypothesis of no effect, and also create a confidence interval based on the normal distribution. So this was actually the most difficult part of this session.
Do you have to know the true effect size in the random effect?
Yeah, so do you have to know the true effect size in the random effects model? So that's basically the effect size that you want to estimate. So you don't know the true effect size, but that's what you're going to estimate, the true effect size, which is here denoted by mu. And the mu is actually the line that is in the middle of this normal distribution going downward. So that's the parameter, so the average effect size in which we are interested. That's what we are going to estimate.
What are the blues in the random effect model?
So the blues in the random effects model are the true effect sizes. And then the red squares reflects the observed effect sizes. So we wanna, what we see in the papers are the red squares, but in the end, the red squares estimate are the blue circles, and what we wanna estimate in the meta-analysis is this line, and this line is denoted by mu. Okay, but what is most important is that you realize that there are two different models in a meta-analysis, fixed effect model and a random effects model, and that you should carefully consider which model you choose, and that you should use theoretical arguments for choosing one of the two models. Okay, so to give an example.
There is no statistical test to determine which is the best?
Yeah, okay, so there is a question, is there a statistical test that can be used to determine which model you should select? So there is a statistical test that you can use to test whether there is heterogeneity, so that whether there is between study variance. So actually means, are we dealing with a distribution of two effect sizes, or is it just one value? But it's pretty bad practice to use such a test to determine whether you should use a fixed effect or random effects model, because this test does not have very good properties. So you should always use theoretical arguments to decide on which model you want to use.
Can you just give one example of why we do choose fixed effect?
Okay, so a fixed effect model could be useful if you, for instance, imagine that you want to test a particular drug and it's a rare disease, and that you have, you know, all the people that have that particular disease. So then you could sample from that population studies to be included in your primary studies. And then if you have multiple primary studies, so you have conducted multiple studies to examine whether a particular medicine, for instance, whether it works or not, then you could combine these in a fixed effect model. But usually people use a random effects model since they want to generalize to the population of studies.
Then wouldn't you think that there'd be, I mean, I don't do medicine at all, but that there'd still be some level of variation in how the medicine would affect different humans?
Yeah, so that's possible, but what you can usually do, and that's what I will discuss later on, is that you can also take those variables into account. So you can also take those differences between the participants into account. Okay, so the example, Marianne already talked about this. So this is a meta-analysis on what is called PSI, or extrasensory perception. And what it basically means, so there is a definition over here, but what it basically means is that you can look into the future. So that would be very interesting if that's possible, of course. So a paper was written about this, and it contains 9 experiments, and 8 of those 9 experiments showed that there was a significant result in favor of Psi, so suggesting that we could really look into the future. So to give an example of such an experiment, so you have, as a participant in such an experiment, you are asked to sit behind a computer screen, and then you get two closed curtains, and then you are asked to, okay, behind one of those two curtains is an erotic picture, so could you pick the curtain where the erotic picture is behind?
The left, definitely the left.
The left? Okay, okay. So you're actually right, because... And that's and that's actually also what was observed in the study, because the results of the study were showing that people could actually identify the future position of an erotic picture. So an effect size of a Cohen's d of 0.25 was observed, which indicates that that's a small effect, but still. It also shows, okay, we can, as human being, really look into the future. So this was just an example of one study, but multiple studies were conducted, and both the existence and the absence of Psi was found, and then a random effects meta-analysis was conducted, showing that the average effect size was 0.09, and it was statistically significant, so also the meta-analysis showed that we could really look into the future. So we could, of course, discuss whether it is possible or not. It seems too good to be true. But the conclusion is, based on this meta-analysis, Psi does really exist. We can really look into the future. However, it is also possible that this meta-analysis and the primary studies are biased because of, for instance, publication bias or questionable research practices or researcher degrees of freedom, as Marianne was talking about. So what we did in the example, the meta-analysis in the example, was a very simple meta-analysis. We are only interested in the average effect size. So that's called a univariate meta-analysis without predictors, basically. So what you usually want to do is that you want to use a meta-regression analysis. And in a meta-regression analysis, what you're trying to do is you try to predict the differences between the primary studies included in a meta-analysis by including predictor variables. So heterogeneity or between study variance in the true effect size implies that the true effect sizes differ. So that implies that the tau squared is larger than zero, and thus that we that there is a distribution of true effect sizes from which the true effect size in the primary studies were sampled from. So this heterogeneity can be attributed to either random or systematic difference between the true effect sizes, and to give some examples of those systematic differences that you can take into account in your meta-analysis. So for instance, there can be methodological differences between the primary studies. So think of if you have studies in your meta-analysis that, for instance, a group that uses a between subjects design and others that use a within subjects design, that could cause differences, that could cause heterogeneity. Another option is difference in the studied population. So imagine if some studies are based on only males and other studies are only based on female participants, then it could also cause a difference that we want to take into account. And more from in a medical context, there can be difference in the length of a treatment. So some studies may use, for instance, if they want to examine whether a drug is efficient, they use another dose for the drug than in other studies. So that could also cause differences. So all those aspects can cause differences yielding to heterogeneity in true effect size. And we can include those characteristics of the primary studies in the model, in either a fixed effect or random effects model, to explain this between study variance. So it's actually the same as you would do in a regression analysis, for instance, where you also include predictors to explain the variance. And that's also why it's called a meta-regression analysis, because as you see over here, these are just regression equations, basically. So we try to include predictor variables to explain the variance. So you can use a fixed effects model with moderators, and if you want to extend the random effects model with moderators, this is called a mixed effects model. And the amount of heterogeneity is also estimated in a mixed effects model, but then it's the amount of residual heterogeneity, so the observed heterogeneity after including moderator variables. Okay, so what is interesting to know and also necessary to know is that meta-regression may reveal interesting relationships between the variables. So it can be very helpful to use a meta-regression as for generating hypotheses for future research. That's possible. However, you should be careful that you do not make causal statements, because it's not an experimental design. It's not a randomized clinical trial. So it's only an observational study, and therefore you could only use it for hypothesis generating purposes and not to see whether there are really relationships between variables, because for doing that you should definitely conduct either an experiment or a randomized clinical trial, an RCT.
Yeah? Thank you. I'm sorry if I'm taking you a bit because I'm relatively new to this approach. What determines the effect size in meta-analysis? And is it relevant to all kinds of studies?
Sorry?
Is it relevant to all kinds of studies? And what determines the effect size? That's the first question.
Yeah, okay. So what does the effect size mean? So imagine that we have 10 studies. Each of those 10 studies studies a relationship between a variable that we are interested in. So for instance, academic achievement. And the academic achievement, so the results that we obtain, for instance, in a regression analysis, that's the effect size. So the score on academic achievement. And then what we are going to do, so we have 10 studies, 10 effect size estimates on academic achievement, and then what we want to do is we want to compute an average effect size estimate across all those studies. because we think, okay, if we combine all those studies, we have, we get a more representative estimate of the academic achievement. That's the idea of a meta-analysis. So that's the effect size.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Can you go back to the previous slide?
Yeah.
So in this case, let's say in your regression, why will the outcome will be like the effect size from each study?
Exactly. So the
and
y.
The x will be like sort of several characteristics of such studies, like say sample size.
Yeah. So good question. So what is y over here? Yi reflects the effect size, so the score on academic achievement. That's the yi over here. And those x variables are the predictor variables. So for instance, characteristics of the studies that we want to use to as a predictor in our analysis. So this could be, for instance, to give an example, the year in which the study was published. That could be included as a moderator variable, so as the x over here in the meta regression.
But we have sort of like, isn't there like a minimum criteria on how many studies you should have to conduct a meta regression?
Yeah, so in principle, how many studies do you need to conduct a meta regression? That really depends on the effect size. So what you could do in principle, you could do a power analysis to determine how many studies you actually need to observe a statistically significant effect. However, you only have the amount of studies available that's in there in the literature, so you cannot really create studies by yourself. So usually there are no real strict guidelines on this, but the more the better, of course.
How do you know that the thing that you're including, piece of data from my study, isn't the result of all the things that we've been talking about the past few days, like data dredging? How do you know that if you're looking at educational attainment, I didn't measure 25 variables, I dredged my data, I got a significant difference, I put it in a paper and you put it in your meta-analysis?
Mm-hmm.
Can you take that into account?
Yeah, okay, so that's a very, very good question. The question is, so how do we take into account, for instance, that researcher degrees of freedom were used in the primary studies? So that's indeed very difficult, and it's hard to take that into account because you have a multitude of different researcher degrees of freedom and all have a different effect on the effect size estimate. So that's definitely a drawback of a meta-analysis. However, on the other hand, it's also a drawback of that primary study. So it's not directly related to meta-analysis, but it's just related to the way as some people do science nowadays. Yeah?
With the journals, are they? Is there a lag time for the more recently produced journals that you're not getting into the sample for this technique?
You
must draw them from a database, and that has to be assumed to be updated?
Yeah, exactly. So it could indeed be the case that you cannot include all studies since not all studies are already in a particular database, so you can just not observe particular effect sizes that you would like to include in your meta-analysis. That's possible. What you could do is you could, of course, always update the meta-analysis if new data becomes available. So that's an option. But this is indeed possible that you do not have all the studies because some studies are just not visible in the database yet. However, if there are preprints of studies, then you could also extract data from those preprints and then include it in your meta-analysis. Yeah?
So is there a way to account for the different methodology that was used to generate the effect sizes? Because this also, like if you had different mixed methods, this would also influence the effect size. And several studies, as robust as checks, also use different sorts of methodology to come up with a result. And would you use them, the different effect sizes reported in, like let's say a study uses three or four different methods just as robust as checks, would you then use all the methodology, like all the different regressions in the paper, or would you, in the planning of your meta regression, already just focus on one type of methodology?
That's up to the meta-analysis, what he or she wants to do. So you could basically do both. That's just It just depends on what kind of conclusion you want to draw. So what kind of research question you want to answer. So you can do both.
But in general, if you're comparing simulations and fixed effects models and general regressions and descriptive analysis, would you then pull them together because they all have effect sizes that you're interested in?
Yes, as possible. If indeed you want to answer such a research question, then you should include it all in your meta-analysis. Yeah.
Did I understand you correctly? So what you just mentioned, is that not what the meta-regression is? Is the meta-regression not taking the different methodologies of the different experiments and using them as predictor variables on your mean of the study means?
Yeah, so that's one option. So indeed, if there are different methodologies used in the primary studies, then you can include that as a moderator in the analysis as a predictive variable in the meta-regression. That's indeed an option. So think back of the example that I gave with the within subjects and between subject design, a difference in methodologies that were used in the primary studies, and that can be included as a predictive variable in the meta-regression.
Is that not what you were presenting, or were you presenting something slightly different?
No, that's exactly what I'm presenting.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah?
I was just wondering whether the outcome measure, are you assuming that the outcome measure is always the same across the studies? Does it have to be exactly the same because we're interested in the effects on that particular outcome measure? Or because sometimes, like,
yeah.
Concepts and circles are measured in different.
Exactly. So that also depends on what kind of question you want to answer. So if you want to answer a really broad question, then, of course, you can include all those different outcome variables. If you have a more more limited research question that you want to answer, then you can focus on only one particular outcome measure.
Okay, but you can.
You can do both. Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so we have the heterogeneity, the between study variance, so the differences between the studies. Between the studies, true effect sizes, and it can be measured. In multiple ways. So quite nowadays, most often used is the Desimonian Laird method. However, this is not the best method. So if you want to use, if you want to conduct a meta-analysis by yourself, you should better use a restricted maximum likelihood approach or a Paolo Mendel approach for doing this. A drawback of this, however, of estimating the tau squared, estimating the heterogeneity, is that those estimates are usually imprecise, and especially imprecise if the number of effect sizes are small. So therefore, it is advised to compute also a confidence interval around this amount of heterogeneity. And you can do that by two methods, the Q-profile method and the generalized Q-statistic method, but I wouldn't go into depth with respect to those methods. Then a drawback of estimating the heterogeneity, which is a very important topic in meta-analysis, is that it cannot be used to compare across meta-analyses. So if you have two meta-analyses, one that estimates the between-study variance as, for instance, 0.1, and the other one estimates the between-study variance as 0.5, you cannot compare the two. So, and for that purpose, another statistic was developed that is now very often used, which is the I-squared statistic. And what this statistic describes is the proportion of between-study variance, so the heterogeneity, related to the total amount of the total amount of variance. So it's actually a ratio of the between study variance divided by the total amount of variance. So the different guidelines how to interpret such a number. So the R-square statistic ranges from 0 to 1. So 0.25, then it said, okay, it's low, 0.5, it's medium, and 0.75, it's large. And you can also use the Q-profile method and the generalized Q-statistic method to construct a confidence interval around this I-squared statistic. So if you ever are going to do a meta-analysis by yourself, you will definitely have to report the I-squared statistic in your final paper. And the advantage of the R-squared statistic, once again, is that you can compare it across meta-analyses. Okay, so there's a pretty diverse background of people using different software. So the software that I usually use is R, and then the Metafor package for conducting meta-analyses. However, there are also all different kind of software programs that you can use for doing a meta-analysis. For instance, you could simply use Excel or software that was specifically developed for conducting a meta-analysis. So for instance, the comprehensive meta-analysis software, which is pretty expensive and not free. So you should definitely take that into account. And finally, you could even use multi-level software to fit particular meta-analysis models. So there are also some other models that we can use in a meta-analysis that I will not discuss pretty much. But what is important to remember is that you can basically all the methods, also the models that we just described, fixed effect and random effects model, can also be fitted by using Bayesian statistics. So keep that in mind, because it can definitely beneficial, especially if you only have a small number of studies in your meta-analysis. Okay, so then, in principle, meta-analysis is a nice tool, but there were also some criticism on the use of meta-analysis. So first of all, some people said that it was just an exercise of mega silliness. Then people said, okay, and this was in 95, a meta-analysis is statistical alchemy for the 21st century. And yeah, of course, on every statistical method, you can critique every statistical method. So to give some of the most important criticisms, some were also already discussed this morning by Sean. So first of all, it's about mixing apples and oranges. So you put all different kind of studies in a meta-analysis, and then you try to come to a conclusion. So that's one of the critiques. And actually, so it always intrigues me. So in English, they call it apples and oranges, but we in the Netherlands, we call it apples and pears for some reason. I don't know what reason, but it seems to be the case. Okay, so mixing apples and oranges, all diverse studies, that's possible. You can combine very diverse studies, so as I said before in answering a particular question. But then if you put all different kind of studies in your meta-analysis, then you're actually conducting a meta-analysis on a fruit salad and not on apples or oranges. So you should take it into account. So do I indeed focus on one outcome measure or multiple outcome measures? And do I go for the fruit salad instead of the apple or the orange or the pear? Now, another critique that was already discussed, garbage in, garbage out. So of course, if the quality of the studies is low, the quality of the meta-analysis will also be low. So meta-analysis is not a magic method that improves the quality of the primary studies. So meta-analysis is as good as the quality of the primary studies. And then finally, okay, publication. Yeah, sure.
Would you caveat that by saying, what if the only real problem with the primary studies is small sample size?
Mm-hmm.
And then you get enough of those, then could you theoretically, like, so they're all well conducted, they're just small.
Yeah.
Adding those up, do you effectively get better evidence? I mean, that's
So that's if you only have small studies, no bias at all, then you could definitely use a meta-analysis, because then it's just the best method to estimate the average effect size. Because the quality of the primary studies is good, although the estimates will not be very accurate because you use small sample sizes. But then this is the right situation to use a meta-analysis to just combine all those studies to get a more accurate effect size estimate. And this works fine as long as there's no bias, because if there is, for instance, publication bias, then everything goes wrong in the meta-analysis, especially if you have studies with small sample sizes.
I don't want to beat my dead horse here, but in the area that I work in, people do meta-analysis of studies, and every one of them is data dredged. So they take a bunch of studies that almost certainly were all reporting chance findings,
mm-hmm.
and they do a meta-analysis of it, and it gives the interventions that they're looking at more credibility. So not only may it not be very good, it may actually make the situation work.
Yeah. So this actually indicates that the quality of your meta-analysis is as good as the quality of your primary studies. So this is a good example of that. But also, if you want to interpret those primary studies in isolation, so not in a meta-analysis, then you can also hardly interpret those results, because if the researcher's degrees of freedom were used to get particular results, then the results will be biased either way. So it's not a problem by definition of a meta-analysis. It's also a problem of the primary studies.
It's a problem if the meta-analysis ignores that. I've no way of knowing this, or I'm not going to take
but
despite that, I'm going to do a meta-analysis.
I agree. Meta-analysis ignores the researcher, if researcher degrees of freedom are used. However, there's no statistical methods that can be used to get reliable estimates in case of data dredging or researcher degrees of freedom. Yeah?
You might speak to this shortly. Would you recommend then, or do you ever do this, take a subset of studies that are high quality, which I find is a very vague term, but I've seen that in the literature, and see if, would you do that yourself, or is there an argument not to do that?
Yeah, so what you could do in a meta-analysis is indeed code the primary studies as being of high quality and of low quality, and then include this as a moderator in your in your meta regression. So that's indeed possible. But it's always hard, of course, and subjective to say, okay, this is of high quality and this is of low quality. Although there are some standards in a medical research checklist that you can go through to find out whether a particular study is of high quality or not. Yeah?
So I just wanted to point out that nowadays, with people paying more attention to pre-registration, it is actually possible to do these meta-analyses on pre-registered studies, sometimes in the context of registered replication reports. And in that case, you can be fairly confident that these kinds of practices that we worry about and we should worry about either do not exist or are of minimal importance.
Yeah.
I find those meta-analyses actually really compelling.
Yeah. I fully agree, and what you could also do is, if you know that some studies are pre-registered replications, then what you could also do is code this as a moderator and also include in the meta-regression. So it's actually the pre-registration is an indication of quality of these studies. And you could, if you include it in as a predictor in your meta-regression, you are basically also doing only a meta-analysis based on the pre-registered studies.
So, but you could do the same thing if you rate articles on quality, and then one way is to select just the best studies, but the other way would be to include quality as a predictor.
Yeah, exactly. So other people also have proposed to use only, for instance, the 10% most precise studies in a meta-analysis for estimating the effect size. So that's also an option indeed. Okay, and finally, the last critique is publication bias, so that publication bias may invalidate your meta-analysis. And this is what we will discuss later on. So for this first part about meta-analysis, you take home messages. So meta-analysis is, in principle, a powerful tool to aggregate findings from different studies. However, the quality of the data determines also the quality of the meta-analysis. So we should always keep that in mind. Then theoretical arguments should motivate whether you use fixed effect or random effects model. And finally, if you want to explain the between study variance, the heterogeneity, then you cannot make causal statements. So you should only use it for hypothesis generating purposes. Okay, so are there any remaining questions on meta-analysis? Okay, then let's continue with a short movie. Not from YouTube, because I do not really trust the internet here. So I downloaded the movie, and hopefully it maybe takes some time. Or did I do something wrong? I just switched from PowerPoint to...
Well, could be too high res. Like, I mean.
No, but it doesn't have input, so.
Yeah, I mean, like, what?
This is pretty weird.
Back. What's your, like, the. What's the. F8. Is that how you normally?
No, I can switch between screens.
Ah, I would just.
Is that gonna come back?
Oh.
Okay, so that's
okay.
Back. And
okay.
Then. Ah, excellent. Okay.
Maybe it's a good idea to turn off the lights here.
What's that?
The turn off the lights.
Oh, yeah, how do we... this now it brings it in front of this. Dustin, how do we get to here?
Thank you. Okay, so you may think the guy was talking about weird statistical formulas and meta-analysis, and now he's showing such a video clip. Why is that? So, to get back to the right slide. So this actually, this was... just a second. Yeah. So this actually was... this actually was Slade Manning playing with ping pong balls. A 3-minute video based on 3 years of playing. So some tricks needed more than 5,000 attempts. So what he said about the video, I didn't really have any skill or control, so it was just a matter of hitting balls over and over until one finally happened to go the right distance and direction. And actually, what you see is not all what happened. And this also holds for science. But it's probably not as bad as with this video. So probably not 5,000 attempts. Hopefully. But we don't know. So what is publication bias actually? Publication bias is selective publication of studies with a statistically significant outcome. And there is some longer history on dealing with publication bias in medical research than in the social sciences. But nowadays, there's an increased attention for publication bias in various fields, actually. So to show some evidence for publication bias, this is a figure adapted from a paper by Fanelli, published in 2010. So it may be somewhat hard to read, but what you see is on the x-axis a percentage of papers reporting support for the tested hypothesis, so basically meaning a p-value below 0.05. And then the x-axis ranges from 50% to 100%, and then you see all different kinds of research fields. So if you are in space science, you're very lucky, but I suppose there are no people from space science here, but then if you are in psychiatry or psychology, you're pretty unlucky, because the amount of statistically significant results in psychiatry and psychology is up to 95%. And this is actually not in line with the amount of statistical power, so it's highly unlikely that all those results are true. So if we assume that the statistical power is 50%, then it would suggest that only 1 out of 40 of the statistically non-significant results get published, if the true effect size is of medium size. Then it would mean that only 1 out of 40 statistically non-significant results get published. So this is really shocking, I would say. So some more evidence. This line shows the positive results in a sample of articles between 1990 and 2007. So you see an increase in statistically significant results up to 85% in 2007. Then more evidence, we have a pretty old paper already, published in 1986, which surveyed researchers on the effects of positive findings. And what you see is that in this table, that in the rows we see a positive, so statistically significant results, or neutral or negative, non-significant results. And in the columns we see the submission decision. So did authors actually submit a particular article if it contains positive or negative findings, and what you see is that way more positive findings are submitted than negative or neutral findings. So publication bias is not only caused by editors and reviewers rejecting papers with non-significant results, but also by authors not submitting articles with statistically non-significant results. So then another table, now showing whether, if a study gets submitted, whether it gets accepted. So what you see, positive result gets way more accepted than a negative, neutral result. And then finally, how many studies actually get published, so the total amount of studies, also the studies that were not submitted for publication, then we also see positive results are more often published than negative results. Then we also have some more indirect evidence for publication bias, which is related to the reproducibility project Psychology that was initiated by the Open Science Collaboration. So what they did is they replicated 100 studies that were published in three different journals, and the results shocked many people inside and outside academia, because the results showed that 95% of the original studies were statistically significant, and only 36% of the replications were statistically significant. And the effect size estimates, those decreased from a correlation of 0.4 to a correlation of 0.2. So there was definitely something going on in those original studies when you compare it to the results of the replication. And I always really like this this figure describing the p-values that were observed in the original study and replication of the reproducibility project, because what we see on the x-axis is the p-value in the original study ranging from 0 to a bit more than 0.05, and the y-axis are the p-values in the replication ranging from 0 to 1. So what it actually means is that those studies over here, those p-values, those were statistically significant in the original study and replication. And all the others, those were not significant in the replication. And the ones in this block were not significant in the replication, but statistically significant in the original study. So this indicates that there's definitely some sort of bias. So those kind of projects, reproducibility projects, were also initiated in other fields. So in economics, 89% of the original studies were significant, 69% of the replications. In hematology and oncology, 11% of the studies were deemed to be successfully replicated. So it was also not very high. And of course, there is some critique on those projects. However, the results are pretty clear, so even it is a bit less worse than shown in these projects, there is definitely still a problem. Question?
Yeah, thank you. How do you handle methodology variations across the primary studies?
What do you mean, in this context, or?
Yes, in the context of meta-analysis.
How do you take into account differences between methodologies
across primary studies?
Yeah, so difference in methodologies across primary studies, then you could do basically two different things. You can either include it as a predictive variable in a meta-regression, or you can just run two separate meta-analyses. That's also possible if they are really distinct methodologies. Yeah?
In the preceding example, do you mean that the observation, the conclusion was that those who reported false p-value were close to 0.5, or the majority?
So what do you mean?
Do you mean that those, when they replicated, those who reported false p-value were close to 0.05 or close to 0.0?
So yeah, it both could happen. I don't know actually what the results with respect to that are, but the results could be, they were at least statistically significant, so they were between 0 and 0.05. So what we know based on additional analyses is that the studies that were, and it's also what you see over here, that the studies with a very small p-value, that they could also be replicated in the replication study, suggesting that they were also statistically significant in the replication study. So that's what we know. Okay? Does it answer your question? Okay, so two possible causes of this low replicability could be, on the one hand, publication bias, or, as we discussed before, questionable research practices or researcher degrees of freedom. Okay, so now I have a question for you. What do you think are the consequences of publication bias. So why actually is publication bias so detrimental for science? Yeah, go ahead.
The majority of the studies are mainly for policy suggestions. So when you conduct a study and that there's publication bias, you may wrongly inform those who will make a decision regarding a particular solution, so which is really a detrimental effect.
Yeah, exactly. So these are basically two reasons. One reason is it yields overestimated effect sizes, so we make wrong conclusions for policy, as you said. And secondly, we may also conclude that an effect exists based on a hypothesis test, while in fact it doesn't. So that's already a second consequence of publication bias. What's actually also a third one is that researchers may be motivated to engage in questionable research practices. So to use researcher degrees of freedom, because if they know, okay, I should get a p-value of my study below 0.05, otherwise I can't get my work published, then they may use questionable research practices to get such a p-value, to get such a result. Question?
Yeah, I just wanted to add that it kind of throws off the progress of the science, right? Because if you're calculating your sample size based on an effect size that's misrepresented, then your study's underpowered and you don't.
Exactly. So it also influences future research, not only because you may select the wrong number of sample sizes based on a power analysis, but you may also just studying an effect that seems to be there based on previous research, while in fact it doesn't exist. So it's also a waste of money. Okay, so I would like to say something about different publication bias methods that exist. So there are a wide variety of different methods that you can use for assessing publication bias, and I will discuss some of them. And I will do that based on an example of a meta-analysis by Ribello, published in 2015, which was studying the effect of weight on judgments of importance. So what does it mean? For example, there was an experiment where participants were held in a heavy clipboard, and then the dependent variable of interest was the fairness of decision making. So are people that are holding a heavy clipboard, do they make different decisions related to some fairness situation than people that hold a light clipboard? So what the meta-analysis showed is we have 25 studies and a particular strong effect, an effect of 0.5 it is, which is statistically significant. So this is the meta-analysis that we will use to apply the different publication bias methods to. So first of all, the most popular method is the fail-safe end method. And what this method does, it just estimates the number of effect sizes that are in the file drawers of researchers. So it does that by assuming that the true effect size of all the studies in the file drawers is exactly equal to zero. So it's not a very likely assumption. So this method is pretty popular, but its use is discouraged because it is not a very good method for some reason. So two drawbacks are, first of all, that the method mainly focuses on statistical significance and not on substantive significance. So it doesn't focus on the effect size, but only on if something is statistically significant or not. And the effect size of hidden studies are assumed to be zero. So they cannot be larger or smaller than zero. They have to be zero, which is also an unlikely assumption, of course. So if we compute the number of effect sizes in the file drawers for this meta-analysis, we get a very large number, more than 1,000. So they would suggest, okay, there's no publication bias whatsoever in this meta-analysis. So no problem at all. However, this Meta-disk is should not be used anymore. It's not recommended to be used, so we should just forget this. This is probably incorrect. The other popular method is the funnel plot. And what you do in a funnel plot is you have on the x-axis you have some measure of effect size observed in the primary studies, and on the y-axis you have some indication of the study's precision. So for instance, the standard error. So how precise are the effect size estimates estimated? So and then what you expect, so what you see on the y-axis, the large standard error is at the bottom. Standard error of 0 is on top, so this suggests that the most precise studies with the largest sample size should be at the top of the plot, and then the dots in the plot reflect the observed effect sizes in the meta-analysis. So if the funnel plot is asymmetric, as we can see over here, because there seems to be a gap over here, then this suggests actually that there are small study effects going on. And small study effects means that large effect sizes have a tendency to have larger standard errors, so to be less precise. So this could be an indication of publication bias, but there are also other causes of small study effects. So it's usually pretty bad practice to eyeball such a funnel plot to see whether there is a symmetry or not, because it's sometimes hard to see. So therefore other methods were developed. And two of those methods are the rank correlation test and Eggers test. So those methods study the association between the effect size and some measure of the precision. So in this case, the standard error. So if there is a relation between the two, we would say, okay, there are small study effects in our meta-analysis, probably caused by publication bias. So if we apply the rank correlation test, we find a statistically significant result indicating, okay, there is indeed publication bias in this meta-analysis. Another option is to use the Eggers test. And what this method does is we again have our funnel plot. And what we now try to do is we fit a regression line through these points. And if the funnel plot is symmetric, then we would get a vertical line. Because that means that if we fit a regression line to points that are also, when there are also some effect size observed in this part of the plot, then we would estimate a vertical regression line, suggesting that there was no publication bias. But if we fit a regression line through the observed effect size in this meta-analysis, we definitely see that the slope of this regression line is larger than zero, suggesting that there is indeed publication bias. However, if we use statistical test, we find a Z value of 1.6, but it's not statistically significant. So the test indicates there is no publication bias, although that the line is not vertical, but that the slope is larger than zero. So drawbacks of these two tests in general are that they have low statistical power, so they can hardly detect publication bias if there are 10 or less studies included in a meta-analysis, and they actually test small study effects and not publication bias. So publication bias is a small study effect, but there are also other small study effects that could cause this funnel plot asymmetry. So those methods have low power, so why do we not correct the effect size estimates for publication bias instead of testing for publication bias? So several methods were developed for doing this. One of the most popular methods is the trim and fill method, which again makes use of the funnel plot. So what it now does is, we see here again our funnel plot. And what the trim and fill method does is exactly actually what the name says. It trims some studies from this side of the funnel plot and fills those studies in the other side of the funnel plot. So the filled studies are those open bullets. And then what it's done is it recomputes the average effect size based on the real studies and based on the imputed studies. So in principle, the method is also not recommended to be used because it yields some misleading results, but it's a pretty well-known method and often used in practice, so that's the reason why I present it over here. So if we use this method in our meta-analysis, then we see that the effect size in the meta-analysis was 0.57, and if we correct the effect size estimate by imputing, in this case, 9 studies, we get an effect size estimate of 0.52. So only slightly smaller than if we do not correct for publication bias. And the effect is still statistically significant. Question? Yeah, so I would, in principle, those two are completely independent of each other. So you can either test for publication bias and estimate the effect size. So you can do both. There's no problem in doing that. Then there are quite recently, not recently, but there's nowadays an increased attention for what is called selection models. And selection models are also a particular method to correct for publication bias, but those methods are pretty complicated, actually. And also with respect to the time, I will skip the explanation of the selection models. But what I will do is I show the results. And if we see the results of applying such a publication bias method to our data, so the effect size in our meta-analysis was 0.57. If we apply this method, we get 0.26. So already way lower than our traditional meta-analysis, not corrected for publication bias. Then there's another method, also based on a funnel plot, which is, I would say, really intuitive, and which is called the Pat-Pease method. So what it does, it again makes use of the regression line of the Eggers test, basically. So we saw this figure before, and what we are doing with the Pat-Pease, basically, is we say, okay, if we would have a study with an infinite sample size, so that means a study with a standard error of 0, that estimate should be equal to our true effect size, so the effect size we are interested in for estimating. So that means if we draw this regression line, that the effect size estimate is equal to this point, because this point is equal to a standard error of 0. So this is then our effect size estimate. So pretty intuitive, I would say. So the performance of this method is topic of further study, but and what a limitation actually is that you are not always able to fit such a regression line through the observed effect sizes. Because if you have only a very small amount of studies, then it's very difficult to fit such a regression line. And also, if the studies do not differ with respect to the precision, so the standard error, it's also very difficult to estimate and to fit a regression line through the observed effect sizes. So if we apply the method to our meta-analysis, then we see that the effect size now substantially decreases to almost zero. And it's now no longer statistically significant. So actually the method is slightly more difficult because it's a conditional estimator, but I do not bother you with the details right now. But the idea is we fit a regression line to the observed effect sizes, and the effect size estimate is equal to the effect size where the standard error is zero. So a study with an infinite sample size. Okay, then about the p-curve and uniform method. So I first have to add a disclaimer, because I'm actually, as Gerrit already told you, I'm actually one of the developers of the p-uniform method. So I may be a little bit more enthusiastic about the method than about the other methods. But I will also discuss the limitations of the method. So both methods are actually based on the same methodology, but they slightly differ in implementation. And what the methods do is they use the probability of observing a particular effect size conditional on that it is statistically significant. So what does mean? What is means? That's what I will show later on. So to first give an example of the distribution of p-values when we just draw a random sample. So imagine we compute a p-value, meaning that we compute a p-value, the probability of an effect size larger than the observed effect size, given that the true effect size, the theta, is equal to zero, it's just the definition of the p-value. And we do this repeatedly when we sample from a distribution with a true effect size of 0.2 and a particular variance. So how will the distribution of those p-values then look like? They will look like this. So more p-values close to zero and less p-values close to one. So we have to keep this in mind. So this is in line with a positive true effect size, an effect size of 0.2. If we use a one-tailed p-value. Okay, now what happens? How are the p-values distributed if the true effect size is not zero, or is not 0.2, as we saw on the previous slide, but is zero? So if we again repeatedly sample data and compute a p-value, then we will get this distribution. So we will get a uniform distribution. So this suggests that if the true effect size is equal to, in this case, zero, because we compute the true effect sizes for theta zero, and we also use that for generating data, then we will observe a uniform distribution. Okay, so what we are now going to do is, again, we are going to compute one-tailed p-values, but now at the true effect size of theta is 0.2. So we now compute the probability of an effect size larger than the observed effect size given theta is 0.2. And then the data is again sampled with an underlying true effect of 0.2. So if we do this, we again observe a uniform distribution. And we could use this property for estimating effect size, because this is actually the statistical principle, that p-values are not only uniformly distributed under the null hypothesis, but also at the true effect size. So what the methods p-uniform and p-curve both do is they discard the statistically non-significant effect sizes. And they do this because they know, okay, there are hardly any statistically non-significant effect sizes published. So if we only focused on the statistically significant effect sizes, and we make an assumption that those effect sizes are all published with the same probability, we can use this property, the statistical principle, for estimating effect size. So I'll skip over this and immediately show you how it works. So imagine that we have three observed effect sizes, and our true effect size is equal to 0.5. We have three studies, so with p-values 0.0029, 0.011, and 0.025. And then we compute the p-values, the conditional p-values, so taking into account that the studies are statistically significant. We do this for a true effect size of zero, so lower than the effect size that was used underlying the data. So then what we see is the dashed gray lines refer to the p-values that we would observe under uniformity, and the observed lines, so the black ones, refer to the observed conditional p-values. And what we want that those solid black lines exactly coincide with the dashed gray lines, because then the p-values are uniformly distributed, and that's our effect size estimate. So if we increase the effect size to 0.5, then we see that the lines exactly coincide, and this is the effect size estimate of p-uniform and p-curve. So now the conditional p-values are exactly uniformly distributed. And if we would use traditional fixed effect meta-analysis, so do not take publication bias into account, then what we see is that the lines reflecting the observed conditional p-values are larger than the dashed gray lines, conditional p-values that we should have observed under uniformity. So this is in a nutshell how the estimation works with p-uniform and p-curve. So in principle, this means that if the average p-value of all the studies in our meta-analysis is larger than 0.025, then this means that the true effect size is estimated as smaller than zero. If the average p-value is exactly 0.025, then it's equal to zero. And if the average of the p-values is smaller than 0.025, then this suggests that the estimate will be larger than zero. So some advantages of p-uniform over p-curve is that p-uniform can also be used for the effect size estimation. P-curve can also be used for doing that, but not for estimating of a confidence interval. And also, p-uniform can also be used for testing for publication bias, and that's also not possible with the p-curve method. Okay, so I will skip over this and continue with the conclusion, and then with some with the practical part, so you can do something yourself. So first of all, for the conclusion, I think p-uniform and p-curve are both promising tools for estimating effect size, but they also have their limitations. And limitations are currently that if there is heterogeneity in the true effect size, then this means that the effect sizes will be overestimated. So we are currently working on extending the method. We gave it the name p-uniform star because, yeah, you have to come up with some name to indicate that something different than what you did before. And we hope that we can fix this problem of the overestimation if there is heterogeneity in the true effect size. And the results actually look promising. So if you want to apply the methods, what you could do for p-curve, there's R-code available in a paper by Simonson and colleagues, or you could use their web application, which is available via this website. And for the p-uniform method, there is an R package that can be installed in R via GitHub, actually using the tools that were discussed yesterday in the sessions on Git and GitHub. And there is also a web application that we will use for the practical part. And how does the web application looks like of p-uniform? It looks like this. And what are the options? So what you could do is in this part, you could specify some characteristics of your data. So what kind of effect size measure you use, what kind of alpha level was used in the primary studies, what kind of test was conducted, a right-tailed or left-tailed test. And you could select the particular estimation method. This is more minor technical detail. So you could enter data either via a CSV file and uploading it, or do it manually in a table. But I highly recommend to do it via a CSV file because it's way easier. And then we get the results. So we get an effect size estimate, confidence interval, test of the null hypothesis of no effect. So is there actually an effect? Is the effect in the meta-analysis larger than zero or not? And over here are the results of the publication bias test with also a p-value. Okay, so for the practical part, what I want to ask you to do is, if it's possible with the internet connection, is to download the data of the meta-analysis on the embodied cognition. So the one on holding the heavy clipboard and then influencing the fairness in decision making. And then what you can first do is first inspect the data. So take a look at the data to see how many statistically significant effect sizes are there actually. What is the unweighted mean of the effect size? And what estimate of p-uniform do you expect based on the p-values? And then you can go to the web application, if it's possible with the internet once again, and try to analyze the data. And what's important is that there are two different files, a CSV file and an Excel file that you can download if you type in this link into your web browser. But that you can only use a CSV file to download in a web application. So you should not try to upload the Excel file in the web application, because then it will break down. And then finally, interpret the results and what's your expected effect size close to p-uniform's estimate. So before you start, how does the data look like? It's in an Excel kind of format. So we have information on the effect size. So this means sample means of group 1, group 2, sample size is reflected with N1 and N2, then the standard deviations of the two groups, and we have a T value. And then over here we have the P value, and these values YI and VI reflect the standardized effect size estimates. So YI is a standardized effect size, and VI is its sampling variance. So what you can do is you can go to one of these two links to get the data on your computer and then try to upload it in the web application. And to see what kind of results p-uniform gives if you apply the method to the meta-analysis on the embodied cognition, so on the heavy clipboard, in relation to the fairness of decision making. Okay, so did you in general succeed with submitting, with uploading the data to the web application, getting the results? Okay, then let's briefly discuss those results and then wrap up this session. So you have an option in the web application to export a file describing the results of the analysis that you do with the web application. So if you ask for such a report, then you get a PDF file. First, once again, printing all the data that you entered in the method, that you uploaded in the method. So basically, the information that is available in the CSV file. And then the output that you also see in the web application online is this output. Try to increase it a bit, the font size. So what you see is that the effect size estimate is minus 0.17 with a very wide confidence interval, and the null hypothesis of no effect is not statistically significant. So this indicates that if we correct for publication bias with the p-uniform method, we get an effect size estimate which is way closer to zero than what was observed in the original meta-analysis. So when we just use the random effects model in this case. So if we then test for publication bias with p-uniform, we observe a highly statistically significant result. So there is indeed publication bias if we use the p-uniform method on this data set. And then over here are the results presented for the traditional meta-analysis, so fixed effect meta-analysis. So once again, what we see, if we correct for publication bias, the effect size estimate becomes way closer to zero than if we do not correct for publication bias. Now, one of the questions was, can I predict based on the p-values what my estimate of p-uniform will be? Now, what you could have done is just compute the mean of the p-values of the statistically significant studies, so all the p-values below 0.05. And then if that mean is smaller than 0.025, so your alpha level 0.05 divided by 2, then the effect size would be larger than 0. And in this case, if you would have computed the average of those p-values, then you will see that those p-values are larger than 0.025, implying that the effect size will be below zero, as we see over here. Effect size, a negative effect size estimate. So to conclude, go back to the slides. Same problem, but now, well, not the same problem, not the same problem. And I knew how to fix it. Okay, so take home message. Publication bias is a major threat to the validity of meta-analyses, and it basically yields overestimated effect sizes. So it's very important to remember this when you are conducting a meta-analysis. So there are different publication bias methods, and each method has its own advantages and disadvantages. So the best approach would be to use multiple methods at the same time if you are conducting a meta-analysis and reporting all those results in a paper. So and keep an eye on the development of especially PET-Ps and selection model approaches that I didn't really discuss, and on P-uniform and P-curve, because those methods are still in development and new publication bias methods are developed that probably have better statistical properties than the ones that are currently available. So to go back to our meta-analysis on Psi, so looking into the future, does it really exist? Can we really look into the future? So one of the reasons of the existence of an effect could be publication bias. So a meta-analysis was actually conducted and publication bias methods were applied, and there was no convincing evidence for the presence of publication bias. So still, this could still be that we can really look into the future. However, other explanations are that, for instance, characteristics of the data of the meta-analysis do not really suit the current publication bias methods, or that, for instance, questionable research practices or p-hacking, researchers' degrees of freedom, may be used in the primary studies, and we cannot detect for this with publication bias methods. So it's still pretty much unknown whether it really exists or not. So what then could be done is to start up a large-scale pre-registered replication to study Psi, so to study whether we can look into the future. And people are now actually carrying out such a large-scale pre-registered replication. So hopefully in the near future we know whether we can really look into the future or not. So wrap up, final conclusions. A meta-analysis is a powerful tool to aggregate findings from different studies. However, the quality of the data always determines the quality of the meta-analysis. So that's important to keep in mind. Publication bias leads to overestimated effect size. And there are multiple publication bias methods. All have their own advantages and disadvantages. So just use multiple methods and report all those methods in your in the final version of your paper. So I put also some references to some interesting papers on publication bias and meta-analysis on the slides, on these slides. And these slides are on the OSF. So if you're interested and want more information, just these references are just a starting point for getting more information. Okay, so thank you for your attention.